Hello, and first of all, we would like to thank Mr. Lenski and also the team of the museum for organizing this important conference and for giving us the opportunity to present our paper on Holocaust, the images of Holocaust in the East German art. Anti-fascism was a central element of the national self-image for the German Democratic Republic and became an integral part of everyday political life. For many surviving Jewish communists, for returning exiles, and Jews who had become convinced anti-fascist, the new state was a place of hope and refuge. Nevertheless, the public confrontation with the Holocaust in the GDR only began at the end of the 1950s. Instead of images of misery, murder, and grief of the Jews, the communist resistance to the Nazi regime was dominating the imagery. It was not until the 1970s that a differentiated commemoration of the Holocaust victims began. This development was related to the GDR's political rapprochement with Israel, and as well as the increasing interest of civil society in dealing with the Nazi past. In our presentation, we would like to demonstrate the outlined development in chronological order, illustrated by selected works by various artists and art forms. By doing so, we would like to provide a broad view, insight into the artistic production and the diverse perspectives and forms of the representation that existed in the GDR.
The first works of art dealing with the crimes of the Nazi regime were created during and shortly after the war, primarily by artists who themselves were persecuted because of their Jewish faith and or political stance, and who now incorporated this experience into their work. To illustrate the experiences of individual and structural violence in different situations, the choice of the medium of graphics and its combination in cycles was used quite often, for example by artists as Lea Grundig, Leo Haas, or Herbert Sandberg. Especially in the concentration camps, graphics proved to be the only medium for capturing impressions. The leaves do not strive for a summarizing representation, but can depict a multitude of different facets, and, unlike painting, are able to appeal to a larger audience and made undisturbed private reading possible. As an early example of images of the Holocaust in East German art, we would like to introduce the work of artist Lea Grundig. Grundig was of Jewish faith and a member of the Communist Party in Germany. As such, she was arrested by the Gestapo in 1938. After her release, she emigrated to Israel. Already in the early 1940s, Grundig began working on graphic cycles, dealing with the crimes of the Nazi regime. Unlike the artists Haas and Sandberg, Grundig never was imprisoned in a concentration camp. Nevertheless, she managed to create authentic images that were important contributions to the formation of an iconography of the Holocaust in Germany, in both German states, and that were accessible to public in publications and exhibitions. Only the graphic cycle in the Valley of Slaughter was published as a whole in 1947. We have a copy of this book with us. If you're interested, just let us know. So it was created between 1943 and 1944 and comprises 17 ink drawings explicitly dealing with the genocide of European Jews. It already has been published in Tel Aviv in 1944, where the artist lived at that time, with text in Hebrew and English. The book contains an introduction by the writer Kurt Liebmann. As I said, an expressionist writer who was persecuted by the Nazis. Here he explicitly pointed out the dimensions of the Holocaust in Europe by providing the total number of Jewish victims and information on their origin. The introduction is followed by reproductions of the single graphics with text by Liebmann on the left-hand side. The graphics are arranged and titled as follows. I'm not reading them out loud. But as you can see, Grundig traces the suffering of the Jews from flight, captivity, from deportation to mass murder through the arrangement of the individual graphic sheets. At the same time, she formulates clear requests to the viewer. Sheet 9, titled Help, and sheet 10, you can see here, titled Open are directed to members of the civil society in Germany. Liebmann asks, quote, are people out there hearing the cries for help? But there seems to be no hope. It is followed by, quote, Germany remains silent. Grundig also shows forms of Jewish resistance in her cycle. For example, in sheets 14, which is titled Ghetto Revolt, and sheet 16, titled Partisans, which can be seen on the right. The last sheet of the cycle shows a mountain of dead bodies with a pole in the middle of a ruined landscape. Hitler hangs on its top, wrapped in a swastika flag. The etching is a variation of the traditional image of the shameful sign of a skewered head on a pole. Liebmann writes, quote, at the shameful pole hangs the destroyer, destruction among his own and destroyed himself, to the eternal memory, to the eternal shame. Thus, at the end of the cycle, there is no optimistic view into the future, but a complaint and a reminder of the never-ending guilt in order to prevent a repetition of the recent history. So in the 1950s, plans for the construction and design of the national memorial sites Buchenwald, Ravensbrück, and Sachsenhausen began. The artworks commissioned by the state for this purpose can be regarded as exemplary for the official artistic engagement with National Socialism in the GDR. The individual experiences and impressions of single artists were replaced by a desire for a collective remembrance, which was state-directed and less diverse. While shortly after the end of the war, all victim groups were represented equally, the works of art at the National Memorial Sites focused on the communist, mainly focused on the communist resistance through the explicit symbolism of the Red Triangle. The former Buchenwald concentration camp was the first National Memorial Site in the GDR to open in 1958. The central element of its artistic program was a so-called Buchenwald Memorial by artist Fritz Krämer. The sculpture is firmly integrated into the extensive memorial on the Ettersberg near Weimar. It stands at the end of a long staircase leading up to the bell tower with the eternal flame. Thank you. The sculpture consists of a group of 11 bronze figures representing male camp prisoners. Their body language and the view towards the West are self-confident and militant. And that was of utmost priority of the state authorities, whose central interest was the commemoration of the communist camp resistance, and who had previously rejected two of the artist's drafts for the sculpture, as neither a weapon nor flag bearers appeared in them. The developing anti-fascist resistance art marginalized the commemoration of Jewish victims in the GDR. Even in the GDR state-imposed memorial culture, Jews were initially excluded. At the end of the 1950s, there were only a few works of art that could prove to contain references to Jewish victims of the NS by means of explicit, for example, religious symbols or titles. 2 years prior to the opening of the National Memorial Site Buchenwald, Lea Grundig once again recalled with her etching Wall Call at the concentration camp that not only communist resistance fighters were victims of the Nazi regime. The work shows two concentration camp prisoners supporting a physically debilitated person in the middle. The motive of solidarity among the prisoners can also be found in the painting Hunger March by Hermann Bruse, who also lived and worked as an artist in the GDR. Bruse closely linked solidarity with political prisoners through the symbol of the Red Triangle. Grundig also depicted two political prisoners, but she marked the one in the middle with the Star of David. In doing so, she maintained the GDR hierarchy of victims into fighters and persecuted, but also marked the forgotten group of Jewish victims.
In contrast to the 1950s, when works of art on the Holocaust had largely gone unnoticed, the legal, political, and social reappraisal of Nazi crimes in the 1960s led to the creation of more and more works of art on this theme, which were shown and discussed in art exhibitions. At the same time, the interest in artists such as Lea Grundig or Leo Haas grew. Many of the newly created works of art were a reaction to the Eichmann trial, the Auschwitz trials and in Frankfurt, and the West German debates on the statute of limitations. Works that addresses the group of perpetrators were also used for the anti-federal Republican propaganda. In some cases, the explicit depiction of Jewish victims only took place if, in return, the Federal Republic of Germany could be exposed as a fascist state. An example for the political instrumentalization of the Holocaust is the work of the graphic artist Herbert Sandberg, entitled Eichmann and the Eichmänner. As a Jew and communist, Sandberg was a victim of Nazi persecution from 1934 until his liberation in 1945. He was imprisoned without interruption, the longest of which in Buchenwald. The work Eichmann and the Eichmänner shows on the left-hand side the accused Adolf Eichmann in a retreating attitude and dismissive gesture. Behind him are the Eichmänner, co-defendants in this graphic. Sandberg identifies the co-defendants and marks them in a similar way to the identification of the Jewish population, which can be seen on the right side as the accusers brightly lit. They all raise their right arms and point to Eichmann, a young woman in front with the Star of David on her chest. Sandberg was presented at numerous state art exhibitions in the GDR with several works documenting the Nazi crimes. For example, the graphic Heroes from 1966 in slight variation on the right-hand side was later exhibited at the 9th German Art Exhibition in the GDR under the title, O Buchenwald, I Can Hardly Forget You. It was also the motive of the poster for an exhibition called Confessions, which was opened in Berlin in 1960. The exhibition was a comment on Nazi continuities in the political and legal state bodies, as well as a recurring fascism in the Federal Republic of Germany. The exhibited artists, including John Hartfield, Fritz Kremer, Leo Haas, and Lea Grundig, were invited to, I quote, make a confession against the resurgence of fascism and racial hatred. In Sandberg's work, apart from the serial processing and the recurse to Christian iconography, the integration of the Nazi crime into anti-fascist and communist narrative is conspicuous. These three observations are also reflected in the paintings of the 1960s, which will now be presented using just a tiny example, a work by Werner Tübke. Can you see that? Was it just bright on the stage? Yeah. Tübke was born in 1929. Along with Bernhard Heisig and Wolfgang Mattheuer, he belonged to the so-called Leipzig School and became one of the most important painters in the German Democratic Republic, who also gained recognition in West Germany. From 1964 to 1967, he produced 12 paintings, 16 watercolors, and 70 drawings of the cycle called Dr. Schulze's Life Memories, depicting the horrors of the Nazi regime and its inadequate reappraisal in the Federal Republic of Germany. The most frequently published painting of this complex of works is the third version, seen here, more or less, from 1965. Tübke combines here, in a way that characterizes the Leipzig School, various images and memory quotations to violent scenes of the persecution of Jews without continuous narration. In addition to the media coverage on the legal processes, it was above all publications with pictorial materials such as Schönberner's book, The Yellow Star from 1960, which served Tübke as a model. He almost seems to have illustrated Schönberner's introductory words. I quote, The biblical prophecies of Judgment Day and the fearful visions of Kafka became reality. The monsters of Hieronymus Bosch rose up in human form. They did not have tusks or hooves or the faces of toads. They were clean-shaven, were their hair neatly parted, and were good family men. Dante's Inferno was established in the modern world. Tipke shows murderer and murdered in the scheme of a court, centrally the figure of the judge, over here. The torments of hell on the left side, not as usual on the right-hand side. The agonies of hell, these are the crimes against the Jews, depicted here in all clarity and detail. The influence of historical photographs and their appropriation in the paintings becomes particularly clear in this work. Tipke thus referred to photographs published by Schönberner, for example, an execution scene from Warsaw, which was published in the book. And I don't know if you can see that. It's those two men over here. But provides the executioner with a goat's foot and glasses, referring to Heinrich Himmler. He quotes the rear view of an SS officer whom he depicts with a skull. It's this person, seen here, like you can see the weapon and the skull. The radiating fanned out iron letters on the image of the Warsaw Ghetto. It's this one, seen over here. A dead prisoner lying on the ground. It's this person over here, which he almost copied. And cupboard urns of the dead from Theresienstadt. Okay, that's not that good to see, but here are also written the names. And in that way, he indicates not only the names of the victims, but also the places of the crimes. Numerous references of this kind can be found in the painting. While the perpetrators are always anonymized and depicted with skulls, Tipke shows the numerous and until then nameless victims individualized and thus breaks with anonymity. He integrates the photographic quotations into a complex system of signs and places them in the traditional line of early panel painting, thus creating an artistic space in the GDR with which he succeeds in distinguishing himself from the Western avant-garde, and at the same time integrating the persecution of Jews into a historical continuum of cruelty and violence. In this way, he amplifies the suffering and torment of the Jews more strongly.
Yeah, we are kind of rushing through the art history in GDR, and we're now in the 1970s and 80s. And yeah, that what Jenny just described in her last sentence, this trend intensified in the last two decades of the GDR, when more and more works of art were created that differ from popular anti-fascist art. Overall, a differentiation and expansion of the commemoration of the Jewish victims of the NS can be observed, which seems to be connected to the political rapprochement of the GDR towards Israel and the growing interest of the civil society in the Nazi past. The increasingly abstract artistic examination of the Holocaust, especially the concentration and extermination camps Auschwitz and Treblinka, in the two last decades of the GDR was also striking. For example, the artist Horst Zickelbein created a series of non-figurative paintings that are connected to Auschwitz via their titles. Zickelbein, born in 1926 in Frankfurt an der Oder, studied at the art school in Berlin. From the 1960s onwards, the artist increasingly focused on the abstract effect of forms and above all colors. In March 1989, the work All the Wonderful Women, Auschwitz III, together with the pictures The Hollow, Auschwitz, and 2032, Auschwitz, was exhibited in the State Art Trade in Görlitz. Here it was shown next to a number of abstract landscape paintings by the artist, some of which he made after his journeys to Romania, Yugoslavia, or Cyprus. The foreword to the catalogue praises, quote, the direct experience of the landscapes through the artist's works, as if Auschwitz was a mere piece of land without history. Remembering recent German history, it is surprising that All the Wonderful Women, Auschwitz III, was chosen to be at the cover of the exhibition catalogue. As a last example of the increasingly abstract representation of the Holocaust, we would like to present two paintings by Gerhard Kurt Müller. He volunteered for the German Air Force and in 1943 was taken prisoner of war in France for 3 years. In 1948, he began his studies at the Art Academy in Leipzig, where he later taught as a professor. In the years 1981 and 82, the painting Female Jew, which can be seen here, was created. Just shortly after its completion, it was exhibited in the 9th Art Exhibition of the GDR, where it was acquired by the Dresden State Art Collections. It shows a sitting person in profile, hiding her face in a gesture of grief and despair. Behind the figure, geometric elements such as cuboids, cylinders, and pyramids pile up to a form of an abstract building or kind of sculpture. In the upper part, there seems to form a swastika, below the Jewish woman marked by the Star of David. In the work Kristallnacht, which can be seen on the right side, the central figure is depicted in the middle of numerous abstract forms, and is, due to the monochrome style of the painting, difficult to recognize at first sight. The person holds her hands in front of her head in a protective manner, surrounded by anonymous figures whose faces are reminiscent of gas masks. Stylistically, the painting resembles works of futurism or cubism, and indeed, in the years of its creation, Müller had managed to make a trip abroad to Paris, where he visited the Picasso Museum and the Louvre. The work Kristallnacht was exhibited several times in the GDR and is now privately owned. So we are now at the end of our presentation, and I would like to repeat the most important points. I think it became quite clear that there have always been images of the Holocaust in the art of the GDR. These works were primarily realistic and figurative representations in the traditional art forms of painting, sculpture, and graphic art, which corresponded to the art and cultural political preferences of the party and state leadership. The first generation of artists that dealt with the Holocaust were primarily victims of the Nazi regime themselves and had personal experience with immigration, violence, and imprisonment. In the following decades, the memory of Jewish victims was widely marginalized in favor of the developing anti-fascist resistance art. Also, works of art that focused on the group of perpetrators were primarily used for anti-federal Republican propaganda, as has been demonstrated by the example of the works by Herbert Sandberg. In the course of legal, political, and social processing of the Nazi crimes, the interest in the extent and aspects of the Holocaust grew in the 1960s. More and more works of art were created showing the group of Jewish victims, and those were exhibited and discussed in public sphere. In the 1970s and 80s, a differentiated commemoration of Jewish victims was introduced. The question of guilt of the civil society became more important. Also, it was a time when more diverse art forms were established, a development that produced several works of arts on facets of the Holocaust and abstract formal language. All in all, this topic has only been researched insufficiently so far, as art from the former GDR did not belong to the art historical canon for a long time. This has changed over the last few years. The interest in art produced in East Germany is constantly growing, especially among the younger generation that did not experience the GDR themselves. Works of art works of artists such as Grundig, Sitte, Tübke, Müller, or even Sickelbein become more and more part of museum representations, the academic education, and public discussions. Thank you.
So yeah, I was intended to ask you this question, but I think at the end of your presentation, you maybe already partly answered, but I will ask it. As you are also representing in a way, younger generation dealing with this heavy subject from the history. Could you talk about, and yeah, also another aspect that memory studies, which is of course also very present in arts, is becoming more vivid, more present in also art historical context. Could you speak about new type of revisiting this art of dealing with traumatic history of the recent traumatic history of 20th century and the Holocaust as very exemplary case in Germany? Like, could you talk about some kind of wave or new type of new approaches dealing with this history?
So our own like education in art history, like how
in a broader sense, not just talking about.
I can start. So when I start researching this topic, I thought, or I don't know, books and other people told me that there are no images of the Holocaust in East German art, and also there are still very well-known artists who said there was no art and no like professional artists that created artworks in GDR, because it was all propaganda and like very stereotype. But as we can see, we have different perspectives, different facets that are shown in the art of the GDR, and I think we might be the first generation that can deal with it and like from a kind of a neutral perspective, and not like seeing West and East Germany like black and white. There are also like shades of gray in between, and I don't know.
Yeah, for me personally, it was quite interesting. I mean, I studied in Leipzig and Dresden, like the centers of artistic focus in GDR, and I was also hoping to learn much about the GDR history and especially art history, but they are really just, like, I can count on my hands how often this was a topic, actually, but we...
Meet was once.
Yeah. And, I mean, there are a few persons dealing with art history in East Germany, of course, but then you always have this problem on, like, is it a person who also lived in GDR and was, like, raised there, or even from the Western perspective, and I also recognize that still in our generation, I mean, we were both kind of born in the GDR in 1988, but didn't experience the state. There are still so many, like, strange discussions on West and East perspectives in our generation, which, like, leaves me behind with so many questions. And, yeah, especially the Holocaust theme was mainly focused by now always dealing with the different perspectives of East and West German tradition, so not just focusing on this part.
So does that answer your question?
Or not? Yes, definitely. Thank you. And I guess there are some more questions.
Before questions, I'll utilize that I have the mic. Very brief question. As I understand, the main imagery of the Holocaust is concerning the concentration camps. Yeah, although we know that also from Eastern Germany, many Jews were deported to the East and murdered, including Berlin, Leipzig, here to Riga, for example. Does this topic somehow appear, the deportation in the East German art, or it's absent?
We have to select works we've shown here. So I'd say especially in the very early graphic cycles, this motif is very popular, very present. Because it was, the works were created by the artists who really experienced concentration camps, and later, like bigger narratives were created, and where single aspects like gasification or transportation yeah, was not the center of these works. But yeah, Lea Grundig like depicted it in her graphic cycles. Leo Haas as well, Sandberg did it, and I don't know.
Thank you for this presentation. I think you really discovered something new. The sources for Tübke's painting in Schönberner's book, The Yellow Star, and that really is interesting because it's his method to collage, to make collages from different sources. For the Farmer's War, he did. There is no single invention. Everything was found in a big illustration book on the Farmer's War, but you were the first, I think, who discovered all this. No, not
I would
okay,
love to take
sorry.
The credit, but it was another art historian. What I said, she focused on the different reception in East and West Germany, and what is quite remarkable is that this book was published in West Germany.
Yes.
But of course, they were always like knowing what's going on the other side. So that's a quite good example as well, like, and also how he can.
Yeah, it was
experience those.
The first book, I think, first popular pocket book. But the other aspect I wanted to mention is, following your remark, that there were two big difficulties against Art of Shoah in GDR. First, Ulbricht said in 1947, "Look, don't look back, look forward. We are building up a new society, and you are enjoying your memories," or something like that, he said. And the second was that it was a hidden anti-Semitism in GDR called anti-Zionism. And as Lea Grundig came back from Palestine, from Israel already in 48, and she wanted to go on with printing like the Valley of Death, another book, it was forbidden. And Grotewohl, the Prime Minister, said to her, "It's wonderful and moving, but we don't need it. It's not what we need now here in GDR." So it was practically forbidden to touch this subject matter. And it took a while. Then artists, of course, broke this rule in the 60s, 70s, 80s, and so on. But in the beginning, I think it was really City, the first one, who was remarking the Shoah in his massacre in 1959. But that was the only one I know, besides, of course, Hans Grundig.
And what is interesting in the Sigil painting, he didn't even draw this, like the Star of David, but a pentagram. And he later said that he like mixed it up, and then he, that's also remarkable, and like how,
Thank you for inspiring presentation. And my question is on Lea Grundig as well, her cycle. Do you know who decided about the iconography of the cycle?
Sorry?
Was it an artist? Who decided about the iconography? Who chose the motifs, what to depict? Was it an artist, or did she had any advisors?
I don't know which role the publisher played. I think they just published the whole cycle, 17 drawings, and so there was no more. So this is not a collection, but just showing the whole cycle. And
just would like to make a very short comment with Schoenberg. So his works were in 50s, 60s, right?
Excuse me?
His works with photographs were in 50s and 60s.
It was 1960, I guess.
Yes.
Yeah, in Hamburg.
So 30 years after, we have exactly the same phenomena when a painter, an artist, paints from photography, and it's a late American artist, Partners and Hutchins. She did 40 works from Auschwitz album. Mm-hmm. And in comparison with Schoenberg, she edited. So because art was developing, so we have 30 years of difference, time difference. She added to every painting of her, she added some human detail, like a bow, to the girl in the camp, and from authentic pictures of photography of Auschwitz album, or doll, or so she hypertrophied the eyes, or something like that. And this is some kind of development, because as far as I know, there may be not so many artists who were painting directly from photographs, mm-hmm. making quite individual works of art.
Can you tell me the name again?
Pat Mercer Hutchins.
Okay, I will write it down later. Mm-hmm. That's really interesting. Yeah. Thank you.